How's everyone today? Mouths are full, so I'm assuming the food is good. All right, please keep eating as we go through this presentation today. My name is LeaAnn Petersen. I'm the Director of Public Affairs here at the City of Seabrook, and pleased to bring you our first ever in-person State of the City address. Last year was technically our first State of the City address that we did virtually with video, which was a lot of fun. And so this year we are doing it in person, and we are also recording in the back. So please bear with us with these very bright lights. I'm sure it doesn't bother you all. It's pretty bright up here, though. I'd like to first recognize our sponsors that are here. We have Cobb Finley, which is our gold sponsor. Amoresco is our silver sponsor. Fries Nichols is our bronze sponsor. And of course, Lakewood Yacht Club for allowing us to host this wonderful event here. This lunch is provided complimentary due to the support of our sponsors. So to kick things off, we're gonna kind of start with a promo video of Seabrook and all the wonderful things happening. Kudos to Mick Barnabar, our multimedia producer that put that video together for us. Thank you, Mick. So to start things off, Tom, let's do a little bit of recognition.
Well, great. Thank you, LeaAnn. There's a number of people that I need to recognize that have certainly been instrumental in the success of Seabrook. And first and foremost, my lovely wife, Tamara, the First Lady of Seabrook. 27 years. Without her support, this job would be a whole lot tougher. So thank you, dear. The residents of Seabrook, they're the heartbeat of Seabrook. They're without their support, and I know it's been a tough couple of years here with the construction, and thank you for your patience and understanding. But they're the reason Seabrook was voted the best small city to live in Texas by Money Magazine. And we're very proud of that recognition. Next are volunteers. If there's anybody in the, what can I say about volunteers? I mean, they're all our events, all our boards, commissions. I'll tell you what, if all our boards, commissions, committees, event volunteers, our volunteer fire department. If you could please stand and be recognized, I would appreciate it. Come on, everybody, stand up. You know, these people work thousands of hours. As a matter of fact, we'll get to that later as to how many hours they've volunteered for. But they make Seabrook a better place to live. The quality of life in Seabrook is because of our volunteers. So thanks again. Thank you all. Our public officials. We have our federal officials. Please stand when you're recognized. Representing Congressman Babin's office is Beverly Ferguson Cooper. Congressman Babin has been instrumental in a couple of our major projects and helping us along the way, and we really appreciate your office and what you do. Thanks, Beverly. State Representative Larry Taylor, or State Senator Larry Taylor, I'm sorry. Larry, this is Larry's last term, and we appreciate his long association with all of us, and what he's done is amazing for our cities. The other mayors can certainly vouch for how much Larry has done for all of the Clear Lake area, and thank you, Larry, for all your service. We appreciate it. Representing State Representative Dennis Paul's office is Dawn McDonald. There she is. This light is blinding me from that side of the room. Thank you, Dawn, for being here. Our regional mayors, Mayor Carl Joyner, City of Kima, Mayor Brandon here, Capitillo, City of Baytown, Mayor Michelle Bechtel, Morgan's Point, Jeff Wagger, City of Pasadena, Pat Hallisey, League City, Mayor Kevin Cole, City of Pearland, Mayor Mike Foreman, City of Friendswood, and standing in for Mayor Rigby of LaPorte is City Manager Corby Alexander. Thank you, Corby, for being here. I want to take a second to thank the mayors at that table. Thank you for all your support and all you and the friendship we've formed over the years. It truly is a band of brothers. People don't realize how much time and ideas and things we share. I can pick up the phone at any time and call any one of us. If you need help, they answer immediately. When times of emergency or disasters, they've been there to help. For instance, during the freeze, when we had little or no water because of frozen pipes and broken lines, pick up a call commissioner, and immediately, a large truckload of pallets of water showed up for distribution. I mean, it was a great, great effort that he put in. When we were short of masks early in the pandemic, one call, 1,000 masks show up. It's that type of response that we have with all of these. The mayors, we probably attend 4 or 5 meetings a month together. We go to Washington and Austin together. We actually duck hunt together. Well, at least most times we hold a shotgun and a blind together. We've become very good friends, and I cherish that friendship and that camaraderie. And thanks again for all of you. I told you, Gayle, they'd all show up if there was a free lunch promised. So, City Council. This is a group of people really deserve a lot more recognition than most give. It's not just a two-meeting a month job. It's a part-time job, of course, without the pay. But their only reward is that they try and do the best they can to make the city a better place to live. And for that, I commend them. A while back, I was asked to do an invocation at a elected official mayor and council meeting, and they moved the podium. I said once I was asked, by the way, but they moved the podium way back because they were afraid I was going to get struck by lightning by doing an invocation. So, but they Today I asked God for guidance in making the right decisions for us, for our elected officials, or at least a plethora of excuses for when they don't. And I was very very moved by our council taking up that reign. And I can tell you, I've never seen them make a bad decision. So thank you, council, and for what they've done. We have with us today Mayor Pro Tem Buddy Hammond, Council Member Rob Hefner, Council Member Joe McColl, Council Member Mike Dean Grosso, and we have two council members that unfortunately were on vacation, and Ed Klein and Jeff Larson. So again, thank you for all you've done for the city. Appreciate it.
The decisions that council's making and executing is made possible with the direction of our city directors. Gayle, would you like to mention them?
Thank you, LeaAnn. It's my pleasure and my honor to direct a number of our city employees that have managed our departments, and they're with us today. So I'd like to kind of run down real quickly. Sean Landis, which is our deputy city manager and director of community development. We have Sean Wright, chief of police. Kevin Padgett, our director of public works. Robin Lenio, our city secretary. Michael Gibbs, our director of finance. Jessica and Sarah, our director of courts. And if you know us well, you know George, and I'm not gonna slaughter the last name. George is our IT director, wherever he's floating around. Brad Gowdy in the back is our director of emergency services. Paul Chavez is not with us today, but our director of EDC. Yesenia Garza, which has helped also up front in the back, our director of HR. And last but not least, LeaAnn Petersen, which is our director of public affairs and also one of the key people responsible for this beautiful setup and organization of this event today. So thank you all.
Thank you, Gayle. So we're going to cover a lot today, but primarily we're going to talk about our accomplishments from 2021 and then our strategic priorities of 2022. So to kick things off, we are going to start with wastewater.
Okay. Great. That's a great send-off while we're eating lunch. Well, as you all know, that one of the biggest issues that most cities face is how do we make our city resilient? How do we keep our services up and operating and keep our wastewater treatment plants, our water treatment plants up and running? So again, that lends itself back to the quality of life here in Seabrook. After Hurricane Harvey, our water treatment plant or wastewater treatment plant was inundated with debris. As a matter of fact, there was two houses at some point sitting in it, and we couldn't let our citizens back into the city because there was no way for them to use their restroom facilities because of the sewage treatment plant being down. So we went down a path of trying to figure out how we can afford the cost of replacing that plant on our budget. So we looked at a way to relocate it. It was a $42 million project at the time, and we started down a path that was going to take 20 years to finance. But after Hurricane Harvey, an opportunity for a FEMA grant came available, and with the help and support of our state and federal representatives, the city was awarded a $31.3 million matching fund grant, the federal portion being $23.3 million, and with a local match of 7.8. We've also applied for additional grants from relief from Senate Bill 7 that would reduce our portion to $1.9 million. This is for a $38 million project. It's an incredibly small cost to build a new state-of-the-art facility, reverse the flow of water from the south side of Seabrook all the way to the north side of Seabrook, and 180 degrees, and create a resilient structure that will last for many, many years. I mean, we're very proud of this accomplishment. We've tried for probably the last 30 years of what to do with the sewage treatment plant, and it's a great accomplishment. So thank you, Larry and Congressman and everybody that helped get us that project. Thank you very much.
Yeah, and Gayle, we recently broke ground. So when will this be completed?
So we're looking around probably a 3-year project. It's on our north side of town now, out of harm's way of the surge closer to the bay. So we are fortunate enough to have our project lead team here, engineering firm Cobb Finley, that was responsible for the design, and they worked closely with our city staff. So we are excited. I think it's going to be an amazing project on how clean it's going to be for the environment, and we're excited to get it up and running very quickly. So we hope to stay within the timeline.
Yes, please, within the timeline. Okay. We're going to switch gears now from wastewater to water. We had another big project this last year that kicked off and is pretty much complete. Let's talk about smart water.
Okay, great. Yes, we kicked off a project in July of 21 to replace all of the water meters, every single water meter in Seabrook, to a smart meter. This will allow all of our residents to be able to track their water usage, to see if there's any anomalies in their usage, to try and fix water leaks or whatever. It was an amazing project. It was Ameresco, one of our sponsors here, is a firm specializing in performance contracting, and they partnered with Seabrook. It was 4,150 meters, and they did it within, 6 months? Replace every meter in Seabrook. So amazing accomplishment. We're very proud of this project. It looks like it's going to save the city about $50,000 a year in both maintenance and tracking and billing costs. And now the homeowners can actually themselves, with the new portal open, can actually track their water usage themselves, see if there's a problem, and conserve. If you know, it's a great conservation tool. So we're very proud of this project, and like we said, we actually just kicked off the portal this week. And soon to have most citizens looking at their usage and trying to conserve. So thanks. It was a great job.
And you've already saved some money, correct, Mayor?
Yes, we had a tank that was leaking in our and I got a phone call one night and said, I think you got a problem. You're leaking water. And I thought, I don't hear it, but they actually, during the test, they actually could track that. And so it's a pretty amazing project.
No, and I think, you know, just to add to that, we are excited. Just like the mayor, my household also got to be a pilot program and got in there, understood that we had a leak. So we are also saving money. So we're already hearing from probably, I think, well over 120 of our registered customers are in playing with the portal right now. So it's a very exciting project. We're glad it's completed.
Yeah, officially kicked off February 28th. So we're only 4 days in at this point. So super exciting. So now we're going to focus our attention on the livable center study that we did for the Old Seabrook District. Tom, what is a livable center study?
Well, that's a good question, and if anybody knows, let me know. But this was a project that was kicked off by EDC. We got a $154,000 grant from the Houston Galveston Area Council.
It's a mouthful.
Yes, it's a study to find out how we can improve mobility and transportation and things in the Old Seabrook District. There's been a lot of interest in Old Seabrook in trying to revive that area. Over the years, many studies have been done, but after the studies were done, it was a huge cost, and you know, really never got any traction after the study was done. This, and I'll let Gayle explain a little more on how we implement this study, but it we engaged a lot of the local residents. We had public hearings, we had public meetings, we had surveys, and all that information was gathered, and a plan was brought up, and we seemed to be on track and going with some huge ideas for the area that'll really improve the livability of that area.
Thank you, Mayor. So as he mentioned, when we completed the project, our consultant team along with city staff, one of the resounding comments that we had was, how do we break this up to make it really feasible to get the projects done? And along with everybody that was on the team, as well as the stakeholder group, I think they did a fantastic job. So EDC is going to have something before them very shortly on step one. So we're excited to get the engineering study up and going. And our first goal is to break phase one for just the front portion in the visual that you see for Main Street. So the improvements for Main Street will be our first goal.
Yeah, and we're also where the existing treatment plant that's going to be turned into park ground and lots of parking, and it's a really neat study. If you haven't already, you can check out the entire study on oldseabrookdistrict.com.
Yeah, and we are just very appreciative of, again, the stakeholders talking about volunteers, and Fries and Nichols was the consulting team, and it was just a really great project to work with them on.
Yeah, we're excited. So 2021, of course we had disasters. This is Seabrook, right? I mean, we had the big freeze. Anybody remember that one? And then a hurricane, a small hurricane, but a hurricane nonetheless. So Gayle, I kind of want to briefly talk about emergency response and what our city does during emergencies.
Thanks, LeaAnn. We have gotten really good. As mentioned, we've gone through a lot of disasters here lately. One thing I like to brag on our employees, we have a lot of tenured employees that we've gone through multiple disasters now. And so as bad as it is, we are really good at coming together, getting the EOC up and going. Brad has really directed that really well over the last couple of disasters. And as bad as it is, we get in there, get our checklist done, and get the communications out and inform the public, and it's just as smooth as it can be for going through a disaster. So we've got it down.
Mayor, how many disasters have we had since you've been mayor?
Well, yeah, that's a subject I don't like to bring up too much. I've actually declared six declarations of disaster here since I've been mayor. As a matter of fact, the first one was Harvey that came 3 months after I was elected. And talk about clueless. And anyway, we've weathered them all. I'm very proud of what our city and staff have done. I mean, it's amazing to watch. And when I'm in the EOC, I am mostly watching. So they handle these disasters. They're getting very good at it. I hope we don't have too many more but with the six disasters, I think I'm the only mayor to have more than one. So maybe it's because of that invocation I did, or maybe I'm just bad luck. But anyway, it is a great thing to see, and a great thing to watch how our team works during that time. So thank you.
For anyone that's interested in wanting to come, we're having a hurricane workshop on June 11th.
Right, we have a hurricane preparedness workshop on June 11th. I encourage all of our citizens to come out. There will be more information on the city website when that happens, but it is a great event, and people need to be aware. We have many new people moving in, as you can see, and maybe they haven't experienced one of these yet. So we encourage everybody to come.
Thank you, Mayor. We're going to move into our strategic priorities now. Every year, the City of Seabrook holds a strategic planning workshop where we identify goals and tasks for the upcoming year. This year, we have focused on infrastructure, quality of life, city services, and, of course, economic development. I'm going to let Gayle kind of start us off with some of the infrastructure improvements that are going on right now, in addition to the ones that we talked about earlier.
Thanks, LeaAnn. One of the things we're excited about is our long-range planning has always focused on getting more sidewalks, more trails into our system. And so with 146 kicking off, if you've been in the area, you've noticed that their improvements include a lot of sidewalks on both the east and the west side. So one of our strategic priorities was to look at that connectivity for pedestrian safety. And our intermediate school right now was not equipped to get our kids there safely on a lot of the points. And so we were fortunate to work with Harris County Precinct 2. They have a partnership program, and that was our first goal, is to make sure that we get the longest stretch on Meyer connected. And we were awarded that grant. So it is a 50% grant that we are partnering with them. And we're very excited to get that portion done along with our city crews. So our city crews were able to go ahead and take the first phase and second phase and get that under construction while we're in design with the county. So we're very excited to get that one up and going. And as well, what's near and dear to our hearts, if you love to be outside, I hope you have gone on our trail system. Our trail system is a granite trail system primarily on the east side that is amazing. And the one thing that we've been talking about for the last two meetings, if you've been at our normal small updates, have been that we're getting a grant for Texas Parks and Wildlife to expand 1.4 miles onto the Port of Houston berm across Pine Gully. That now has been awarded, and Public Works is looking at starting that project in early April. That is spectacular, and I hope that once that is completed, you guys get out and enjoy our trail system, because it's a wonderful addition.
Yeah, and Mayor, what's the next step after we get that done?
Well, we're trying to work with TxDOT is to extend that trail across the new 146 highway to tie in with the Yarmin Bio Wildlife Trail. That will double the size of our trail system just by doing that. I mean, this, if you haven't been on our trails, I mean, they're spectacular. They come. And people come from all over to walk our trails every Saturday morning. They're through the most beautiful portion of the city and the state. They're along the bay. They're along the bayous. When we tie it in with the Yarmin Bio system, it'll extend that spectacular view that you have of the wildlife and the flora and fauna. It's a great system, and we get rave reviews on it. That's
yeah, and the amount of events that it brings to the city is just really incredible. We're going to move from our trails on to drainage improvements. We have lots of drainage improvements going on, and one project that just kicked off, Harris County Precinct 2's office is doing that.
Right. We got a $2.1 million grant for the Seascape and Baybrook subdivisions for a drainage improvement project. We appreciate Precinct 2 for helping us out on that project. It will kind of mitigate 347 houses from continual flooding that they have experienced over the years. We appreciate what Precinct 2 did to it, except I'm greedy, and I think Precinct 2 could come up with a few more projects that we can probably handle here in Seabrook. And I'll probably be coming to you very, very shortly. As a matter of fact, if you make time after this meeting, I'd like to talk to you.
Yeah, Doug is shaking his head and saying yes, 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 he will do that. And speaking of utilities, let's kind of talk about Gayle. We have finished the utility relocates at Rebsdorf and East Meyer. I think that is a round of applause of in itself.
Yes, LeaAnn, probably one of our biggest questions that we get is, when is Rebsdorf going to be completed? So this underground work that a lot of people may not know is we have water and wastewater that had to be relocated with this expansion project. We ran into a couple of conflicts at that particular intersection, but now that is complete. And as you can see, the frontage road is being completed in that section. And we are waiting for our next date where we'll move into the traffic transition, which will be onto the frontage roads.
Yeah, Tom, let's talk about that transition a little bit.
Well, okay, we're back on the 146 project. We're 3 years into that five-year project. 3 years and dog years, that's like 21 years, right? And that's what it's felt like. But there is light at the end of the tunnel. Their completion is still slated for spring of 24. Work is continuing on the renovation and widening of the Kima Bridge, the old Kima Bridge. Don't laugh, Carl. I'm not done with you. And it's nice. The old Kima Bridge looks nice, but the new Seabrook Bridge on the west side. I mean, that's spectacular. I mean, it towers over the Kima Bridge by like 2 feet, maybe a foot and a half, but it towers over it. I mean, it is actually a marvel to modern engineering. But, and like I said, the old Kima Bridge looks nice. But now for some bad news. The Red Bluff intersection is going to be a bear for the next couple months. They're still a couple months away from finishing that project, and there's a lot going on that intersection, and then they're going to start the project to LaPorte to the north, and they're staging in that location. So it's that area will be still an issue, but bear with us. You've been patient so far, and we are in constant contact with TxDOT. I hear the phone calls all the time, and we are working through these issues, so bear with us. Thank you.
And as always, we do have a big traffic shift that's coming, so be sure to check out 146.com for that information. We are going to transition now into the next strategic priority, which is quality of life. I'm going to let Gil talk a little bit about what we have on our CIP right now.
Thank you. We are proud of, again, a lot of our park system, which includes our trails that we talked about, but council this last session with our budget process and CIP committed almost $500,000 to projects within our park category. There was a number of items in our park system that needed upgrading, including restrooms and playground equipment, and a lot of that was put onto the CIP, and staff has carried forward with some of those goals, and we're excited to get those projects completed. Also, during multiple surveys that we conduct throughout the community, we also know that a lot of people are concerned that we don't have the boat ramp. That's a project that we're still working in conjunction with TxDOT, so it is on the horizon to come back, but it will most likely be towards the end of the project. With that said, what we did here is please get some kind of water access in our community, and so a couple of kayak launches emerged on our program list, and those are also, one has been completed along Bayside on Main Street, and we're hoping to work along with the county to get one going into Taylor Lake. So a lot going on in those areas on our CIP.
And speaking of quality, I can just shout. Share the mic. We'll share the love. It's all about Seabrook love here in Seabrook. So now we're going to talk a little bit about our events. We celebrated a pretty big event this past year, Mayor.
Yes, we just celebrated our 60th birthday, 60th years in corporation. It was a huge event. We mixed it with our Celebration Seabrook event, and it was probably the biggest attended event we've ever had. As far as family events, it was a huge crowd. We had great bands. We even had I think our the birthday cake was actually 324 cupcakes that went in about 3 minutes. But it was a great event. There was a lot of history. Some of the historical placards are still around here. We had the former mayor's tent. It was a well-attended event, and we appreciate it. But that's it. It is about quality of life, and those are the kind of events we'd like to keep having.
Thank you, Mayor. One final thing staying on quality of life, I'd like to mention our volunteers. You mentioned them earlier, but they are the heart of Seabrook, and they make our lives better.
Well, that's right. Last year alone, our volunteers volunteered for over 3,400 hours of volunteer time. That actually relates to about $97,000 of volunteer time to the city. That's off the bottom line, people. That's very important to have that kind of commitment from these people, and we can't do it without you. So thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. Moving from volunteers into city services, I know that this is a topic near and dear to your heart, Mayor. Our EMS department is still fairly young, but they are doing a phenomenal job.
That's right. We started our ambulance service about 2 years ago. We were contracting with a regional ambulance service, and the problem was the response times were just getting longer and longer. Part of it was due to the construction, but again, we had to do something. The response times were getting to be 7 to 10 minutes, and that's not acceptable. So we started our own ambulance service. Brad and his group have done a tremendous job. Our response times are halved. They're just over 4 minutes now of response time. We're getting huge accolades from all of our citizens that use the service, unfortunately. But it is a very, very important department now, and we can't do it without them. They're great. So thank you, Brad and his group, and good job.
They've been very innovative. They have a new Vial of Life program for all the residents. If they have an ongoing condition, they can put the information in their fridge and easily accessible. It's super neat.
Well, yeah, this is a great tool. Please come, any resident that wants to, that has somebody in their home with a former medical condition, or anybody can come and grab one of these. There's a sticker that you place on your front door that alerts our EMS, police, fire department that there is somebody in here that has a medical condition. You then put this vial in your refrigerator that holds your information on what it is. This saves valuable time when an ambulance or a medic comes into your home. He can immediately see what the issue is, that instead of trying to do all your vitals and everything else, it's all in this little vial. And I think it's a great tool, and I encourage everybody to come and pick one of these up. It could be a lifesaver. So please take the opportunity to use this device. Thank you.
Our police department has been doing a lot in the community lately, Gayle. Let's talk about that for a moment.
Right. So Chief Wright, along with his force, has looked for opportunities after strategic planning to get back into the community, engaging the community in different ways. So a number of Coffee with Cops were held. Also, they kicked off the RAD classes, or rape aggression defense classes, blood drive, and then continued to carry on the tours with a lot of our young kids in the elementary school. And so we've really taken the opportunity to engage back with the public, coming back out of COVID particularly, and getting that one-on-one time with the public, trying to hear the problems, engage with them, and come up with innovative solutions moving forward. And I think it's been very successful.
And police they're not the only ones with incredible solutions. Our municipal court has been recognized statewide. I'd like you to speak on that, because we got a notification from Judge Gregg last night. So comment on that, please.
Right, so we love to brag on our people. We do have an amazing court system and court department that really during COVID took off and took what couldn't be figured out by some cities and made a solution. And so the software that municipalities use quickly identified us as a star city on using the system and still being able to carry out functions day to day. So Jessica, that's with us today, she was actually nominated and awarded for the Excellence Awards, and she's going to be going to Indianapolis and representing the city of Seabrook for what they've done during these last well, I say 2 years now. So they are visited month over month by other municipalities. So it's been a real honor for us to be honored like that.
And we'd be remiss not to mention Public Works, one of the largest departments in the city. They maintain over 14 miles of hike and bike trails, over 200 acres of parklands. That's over 18 named parks, I believe. And the street division maintains over 43 miles of streets. Human Resources is working on new employee recognition and a new intranet. Our Office of the City Secretary organized over 30 meetings, as I mentioned earlier, and 13,000 records scanned in 1 year. And then finally, I'd like to mention utility billing that has done an amazing job with the new Amoresco and smart meter system. They've done a really good job. Thank you all. Okay, I hope you've been eating the dessert because it looks really good, and we're almost to the end of our presentation. We're going to end talking about economic development, and first we're going to talk about the 2040 Comprehensive Master Plan. I don't know that I'll be here in 2040, but Mayor?
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure where they got these dates from when they started this either. As a matter of fact, in 2004, I was on the 2024 Master Plan. I couldn't figure it out anyway, but it is a tool that we use daily. The Comprehensive Master Plan is a group that of citizens that get together and kind of look what the future of Seabrook could look like. Council follows that like a roadmap. If we take the information that is gathered by this group into a comprehensive master plan that we try and follow it. It does change. It is fluid, but we try to follow it as close as we can. It's our roadmap, and council wants to see what our citizens want. So it's a very important plan. We're just kicking it off. We're taking applications for this right now, and I think we're going to come up with a good group of people that'll look at the future of Seabrook and give us some guidance.
So we're currently working off of our current master plan. Sean, I don't know what year that is exactly, but this has brought a lot of new housing, Mayor.
Right. We've got a number of new housing projects and multifamily projects that have been started. We have right now over 214 single-family homes in progress or in design right now. That's just an indication of how many people want to be here. We're very proud of the influx. People want to be in Seabrook. We have very little developable land left, but we are making the most of it. When people see that, well, maybe there's not a lot of space here, they want to be as close as possible, so they move over the bridge to Galveston. But we do have opportunity here, and if people want to be that close, that's fine with us. We have 92 multifamily units that were just completed in Seaside Lodge, which is an over 55 community. We have an additional 90 multifamily unit development that just is underway in Chesapeake Bay. We have approximately 300 multifamily units being planned for Seabrook Town Center. We'll go over that project here in a few minutes, but that's just an indication of our growth and who wants to be here.
Yeah, Mayor, when the number of rooftops increase, economic development increases.
That's right. You know, people don't realize that a lot of the retailers and businesses that want to come here, that's the first thing they look at, is how many rooftops do you have? One of the other indicators that they use is, you know, they typically draw a mile radius around the new location that they're looking at. And, you know, when you look at our circle, well, most of it's in the bay. So, you know, they look for rooftops, and you know how we get them is what we're doing. We're working very hard to bring more rooftops in.
Yeah, and Gayle, let's talk about some of the opportunities that are available along 146 and throughout the city.
Thanks, LeaAnn. We do have a very active economic development department, and with 146 redevelopment, right-of-way acquisition did take out a number of businesses, but it did open up a number of opportunities. And as expected, as we're getting over the halfway mark of the expansion project, that acreage that's available has become very popular. And so people are looking and looking with the best optimization of those remaining parcels. And as you can see, we've got a number of businesses that are looking already at different sites that our EDC works with and is engaging with.
And you know, although the 146 construction slowed down the interest in the corridor, the 146 corridor, we're seeing a huge uptick of interest right now. As you can see on the screen, a lot of those businesses our EDC department meets with on a daily basis. There's people. These businesses are finally seeing the light at the end of the tunnel too of the 146 construction. You know, right now, if we're 2 years away from the finish of that, these people need to get on board now. By the time they do land acquisition, do the design, do the construction, it will be coincide with the finish of 146 right now. So I encourage these businesses to start looking and to start their construction, and they will.
Yeah, and Mayor, if you have any power of persuasion, please bring Whataburger back to the city.
I don't know if I have that much persuasion, but we'll try.
All right, so let's talk about some of the other spaces, in particular, Town Center.
Yeah, we have a couple of updates that I want to put out there on a couple of huge projects. They're very important and we've been waiting for a long time. The first one being Seabrook Town Center. You know, with the unfortunate passing of the original developer, Bill Fredericks, you know, we hated to see, we didn't know what the outcome of that project would be, but HS Development Group has picked up and purchased the land, and the project is going ahead. This project is located just north of Repsdorf on the west side of 146. It's an urban mixed-use development consisting of about 315 Class A apartment units. It's adjacent to 30 to 35,000 square feet of retail and commercial areas built directly around a central plaza. It's got a lot of parking. It's direct access off 146, and we're very excited about this project. It'll be a destination point. You know, it'll be golf cart friendly. Most everything will be accessible from Seabrook by golf carts, by walking, by jogging. But it's a huge project that I think will be instrumental in having a destination for our residents to come to, and you know, I have with us today the developers from HS. Steve Halt. Where is Steve? Oh, there you are, way over there. So we have together today Steve Helm and Harold Sowell, and Gary Johnson is also on the team. Please stand so we can see you. There they are. I can't see you through this light. We really appreciate your commitment to Seabrook, and thank you very much.
So another beautiful project that is going just up the street here, we're on NASA Parkway, is the Hotel PUD that was approved last year, Mayor. Let's talk a little bit about that.
Right. Okay, the second project that we have is one of the most exciting projects, I think, that's ever come to Seabrook or the Clear Lake area. This project came before planning and zoning and city council last year, and a preliminary PUD was approved. This project consists of an extended stay hotel, a boutique hotel, 12,000 square foot of event venue, and numerous restaurant spaces totaling over 20,000 square feet and over 15,000 square feet of outdoor terrace patio. All overlooking Clear Lake. The entire project is going to be constructed on a podium with parking below, and the entire project will be on the north shore of Clear Lake. We're so proud of this project. We're so proud of the developer for bringing this forward, and we're looking forward to it. And now for the exciting news. I've just received a prepared statement from the hotel brand that has graciously said I could read this at this event. And let me read the statement. John Fisher, the hotel developer, has secured the boutique hotel brand Compass by Margaritaville and is in the process of finalizing financing and design approvals. So that's very exciting news. So as you can see, the next few years in Seabrook are going to be pretty exciting. And we're looking forward to our amazing future. So with that, checking my watch, well, it says it's 5 o'clock somewhere. So I want to thank you all for being here, and please be safe. Thanks again.